Welcome to France, the largest country in Western Europe. With a population of 66 million, France is a flourishing country famous for its refined, lavish lifestyle. However, about 200 years ago, France was once a nation filled with conflict and stress, a place of violent uprisings and protest. This time of massive social struggle and political instability was known as the French Revolution. The lower-class citizens, angered by the arrogant royals and increasing taxes, protested for more lower-class support. It was at this time that the great Napoleon Bonaparte's ascent to power began. A close friend of his, Robespierre, had stepped forward to usurp the crown, elevating both his and Napoleon's status and inserting Napoleon onto the international scene.
Napoleon's friendship with Robespierre was the type of exposure Napoleon craved to be recognized on a national level. Once conflict evolved, though, Robespierre's reign of terror commenced, and everyone feared him. Now that Robespierre was widely hated as a leader, Napoleon's reputation was tarnished, and he was considered evil until his superior military skills for the Directory proved his worth.
After the French Revolution, the new French government established the Directory, a five-person executive council. Resurgent royalist forces and supporters of the king were threatening to attack, so on October 8, 1795, Napoleon was made the second-in-command of the army. Napoleon was victorious in this battle, saving the Directory and erasing the negative image Robespierre had left upon Napoleon. As the revolution came to an end, the Directory urged an attack on their greatest rival, England, against Napoleon's will. Napoleon managed to convince the Directory to utilize a more indirect form of attack. By launching an Egyptian campaign, the French could instead threaten Britain's trade routes. In 1798, Napoleon's forces successfully defeated the Mamluks in Egypt, ending Mamluk rule in Egypt. But the greatest military leader was less successful in his initial goal to cut off British trade. Also during this campaign, Napoleon's forces used the Sphinx as target practice, producing the iconic noseless Sphinx seen today.
Although his campaign was not quite a success, Napoleon's leadership and great decision-making in battle put him in a great standing among the French population, a complete reversal from his early years under Robespierre. While Napoleon was in Egypt, though, war was boiling in Europe and France erupted in chaos. Napoleon saw this turmoil as an opportunity to overthrow the Directory, whom he viewed as a bunch of lawyers, and thus decided to abandon his position in Egypt and sneak back to France. Napoleon was able to overthrow the Directory and was named the first of three consuls in France's new government.
As consul, Napoleon's first order of business was to restore peace with France's many enemies, starting with Austria and England. The countries were reluctant to accept France's offer of peace, so Napoleon took matters into his own hands. He commanded a surprise attack on Austria's army, overwhelming them and forcing Austrian Emperor Francis II to sign a peace treaty, the Treaty of Luneville. England soon after gave in to France's immense pressure and signed the Treaty of Amiens in 1802.
Napoleon focused on the most threatening outside forces first, but quickly moved his attention to France's internal problems. In a clever move, he was able to centralize the government agencies and simplify its complex organization. He boosted France's financial economy by establishing the Bank of France and began lycées, also known as secondary schools or high school, which France's current education system is still based on. By far, his most famous influential move was the Napoleonic Code.
The Napoleonic Code was arguably the most important law code in the history of the world. Created in 1804, the Napoleonic Code unified and simplified the complex French legal system. Many changes occurred under the Napoleonic Code. People were allowed freedom of religion, government jobs went to the most qualified, and all citizens possessed equal rights.
However, citizens were not allowed to participate in labor unions. Criminals were harshly punished. Parents were only given the right to have two kids. The remaining weren't even given support. French women also lost practically all of their rights. Divorces didn't have to need mutual consent by both the husband and the wife. The husband got to decide.
And the court! Who cares about- Despite these negative aspects, the code became so popular that Italy, the Netherlands, Belgium, Spain, Portugal, and Germany all adopted it.
Code is the law.
What's better, bigger or smaller?
Bigger!
Alright, so would you rather have a big army or a small army?
Big army, because then you can destroy the other person. If you have a small army, then you'll get killed, and then they'll take over the world. But if you have a big army, then you can go and destroy them, and then you win.
So, would you rather have a big army or a small army?
Big, because the little army will lose, because it will go, and then they go towards each other, and go boom!
So, small armies are bad?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because they lose their heads, and then when they pick it up and throw it in the air, the people
can you find them?
It's not complicated. Bigger is better, and AT&T has the nation's largest 4G network.
Though known for his small stature, Napoleon proved that he was capable of ruling over a nation. In 1804, Napoleon proclaimed himself emperor.
The coronation ceremony took place in the Cathedral of Notre Dame, and he even paid for Pope Pius VII to attend.
At this point, Napoleon strived to make his immense power known throughout Europe. He had invited the Pope to his coronation, but much to the surprise of his nation, he did not allow the Pope to crown him. Instead, Napoleon proceeded to crown himself and then his wife, symbolizing that he would stand below nobody.
After being emperor, Napoleon restored the aristocratic government the French had once had. He granted titles of nobility to his family and those who had served him particularly well. The royal court became a public spectacle.
Throughout Napoleon's reign as emperor, he strived to improve his image and prove his grandeur. Again, Napoleon put a lot of effort into developing and maintaining his public image of grandeur and prestige. By reinstituting the aristocracy, Napoleon gained many powerful allies.
On October 25th, 1805, Napoleon prepared an assault on the British Islands. Upon learning about the assault, the British formed an alliance with Austria and Russia.
The British strategically deployed the resourceful Admiral Nelson to the English channels, creating distance between England and France. Britain's superior positioning caused Napoleon's army to be geographically suffocated.
As the Austrian and Russian armies approached rapidly from the east, enclosing the French army, Napoleon was forced to move his troops to face the oncoming Russo-Austrian army. With strong naval tactics, the English General Admiral Nelson obliterated the French fleet at the Battle of Trafalgar. Just shortly after, on December 2nd, 1805, the French army under the dictatorship of Napoleon defeated the Holy Roman Empire and most of Germany.
When the French defeated the Holy Roman Empire, they created the Confederation of Rhine. France started about here, and then they grew to here. Napoleon remained an envied figure that every surrounding ruler strived to conquer. Other nations were so scared of Napoleon that they formed unlikely bonds to protect themselves. The Russians resourcefully negotiated with Napoleon to ally with them against Britain in exchange for protection for Russia, known as the Treaty of Tilsit. By July of 1807, Napoleon controlled all of Western Europe minus Spain.
Ever since his grievous defeat to the British, Napoleon greatly desired revenge.
Napoleon authorized the Continental System, in which he shut down all European ports of shipping, robbing Britain's market of manufactured goods, hoping to spark a depression in Britain's economy. Russia, Prussia, and Austria agreed to participate in the Continental System and declared war on Great Britain, leaving Spain the only port accepting British goods. However, the Spanish deployed a guerrilla rebellion against France, known as the Peninsulars.
This surprising attack overwhelmed Napoleon, and for the first time in his military career, left him at a standstill. In addition, the British sent more troops to the Spanish guerrillas under the leadership of the Duke of Wellington. Napoleon had been defeated for the second time by the British Empire.
Not only did the Continental system fail to strangle Britain's economy fully, it also showed discontent with French rule throughout Europe because many people could not get the British manufactured goods they were accustomed to. Rather than undermining Britain, the Continental system probably hurt France more than it did any other country.
Driven by an all-consuming desire for control over Europe and angered over a disagreement with the Continental system, Napoleon sent his grand army of 450,000 across the Niemen River into Russia.
The world had never seen an army like Napoleon's, ever. On June 23, 1812, Napoleon set off, expecting to launch a quick assault before the summer had ended, but the heat of the summer proved to be unbearable. By the time they had gone 100 miles, they had already lost around 70 or 80,000 troops. At one point, they were so fed up that they just walked off saying, "To hell with it."
By September, the French force had been reduced to slightly more than 100,000, but still, there was no victory.
The Russians would rather burn their city than hand it over to the French. The governor of Moscow, Count Rospichin, was the one who had ordered the buildings to be burned. Peasants burnt their crops in hopes of preventing the French army from eating. This fire resulted in thousands of deaths, ending with the French retreating in the stalemate when the weather changed for the worse in the winter.
In 1808, Tsar Alexander I was getting upset with Napoleon when Napoleon attempted to recreate Poland as a state. Later on, he defeated Austria and took over their territory. 1 year later, the Austrian War of Liberation erupted, which, thanks to the aid of the German people, the French quelled quickly. Meanwhile, Napoleon's wife, Josephine, had still not given him an heir, and Napoleon was growing concerned. He and Josephine were unfaithful to each other, and after numerous affairs, the couple divorced.
In addition to relationship issues, Napoleon was also faced with political problems in 1810. Alexander I thought Napoleon was too powerful, and much to Napoleon's dismay, Alexander withdrew Russia from the continental system. Without Russia, the continental system was failing to severely damage Britain, and anti-Bonaparte nationalist movements were on the rise.
In 1810, Napoleon married his second wife, 18-year-old Archduchess Mary Louise, who gave birth to Napoleon's son in 1811. Upon being exiled to the island of Elba, 400 of his soldiers volunteered to follow him, a testament to his popularity among his army. Napoleon, allowed to keep his title of emperor, ruled the 12,000 island inhabitants along with his followers and members of his immediate family.
During his time ruling Elba, Napoleon went to great lengths to improve the island. He built hospitals and helped the people of Elba access drinking water. After so many years of ruling almost all of Europe, it really is surprising that he bothered to care for the small island's welfare. But back in France, the French people were reluctant to accept their new ruler, Louis XVIII, fearing that he might reverse the effects of the revolution.
While Napoleon was in exile, the people of France began a pro-Napoleon movement.
Rather than living in isolation on his island, Napoleon was able to learn of this movement through thousands of letters and newspapers he received and was determined to escape to France. The rumors that he might be sent to a remote island in the Atlantic also aided his decision, and on February 26, 1815, Napoleon made his escape to France.
Upon his return, Napoleon was easily able to rally troops, which was evidence of the superior influence of his reign. The peasants of France easily supported him, believing him to be true to the revolution, and wouldn't undo what the people had succeeded. He easily replaced Louis XVIII as a ruler, who had fled to Belgium.
This marked the beginning of Napoleon's Hundred Days. Peasants of the time had already disliked Louis, so they just wanted a ruler that could replace him. They didn't care how capable. In an attempt to increase his support, Napoleon tried minor reforms, but the people of France easily saw through his half-hearted efforts, and his support slowly began to decline.
Even though the people of France had welcomed Napoleon's return with open arms, the other nations of Europe greatly disliked Napoleon's return. March 13th was the meeting of the Congress of Vienna, which was the conference of European ambassadors. They had to put an end to Napoleon in order to maintain their own status and declared him an outlaw. When Napoleon had heard of his fate, he resorted to his usual defense, going on the offense.
Napoleon took his newly raised army and attacked Belgium, where two of the four armies against him were located. He hoped to attack the British and Prussian armies before the Russians and Austrians arrived. After an indecisive battle against the Prussians, Napoleon attempted to attack the English at the village Waterloo. This proved unsuccessful as Napoleon was finally defeated, ending a 10-year period filled with battles instigated by Napoleon, as well as signifying the beginning of the end of his 100 days.
June 22, 1815 indicated the day Napoleon stepped down from his rule, hoping his son would take over. He tried to board a ship for the Americas, but the British Navy stopped all ships departing from that port. Afraid of being executed under the restored rule of Louis XVIII, he asked the British for protection, hoping to be sent to Elba, where he was fairly content. Britain, learning from their mistake, instead sent him to the island of St. Helena in the South Atlantic. Only a few of his friends were able to accompany him. Fairly lonely on his isolated island, Napoleon was given the freedom to wander under the watchful eye of an officer at all times.
It was no wonder Napoleon grew depressed. His life on the island was lonely and boring, especially in comparison to his fantastic life before.
His health began to fail, and on May 5, 1821, Napoleon died. The cause of Napoleon's death quickly became extremely controversial. The first proposed cause of death was stomach cancer. However, his body was remarkably well preserved, and traces of poison were found in his hair follicles, symptoms of arsenic poisoning. Then another question came up: who killed him?
There are five new suspects in this investigation: the valet, the neighbors, the jailer, and the count.
What is your name and relation to Napoleon?
My name is Merchant, and I was his valet. Is this about his death?
Yeah.
You think I poisoned him? I love Napoleon. I would die for him. I cared for him at his deathbed. Plus, why would I kill him? My inheritance from him was so small that it wouldn't be worth it to kill him anyway.
My name is Hudson Lowe, and I was his caretaker.
Did you poison Napoleon?
Poison him? Are you crazy? If I had poisoned him, then England would be in so much trouble with France, and that would be horrible for my English homeland. Besides, I never even saw Napoleon for the last 5 years of his life.
My name is Mr. Bertrand. This is Mrs. Bertrand. We were his neighbors on St. Helena.
Did you poison Napoleon?
He was poisoned? No, of course we didn't.
You were forced to stay on St. Helena for a very long time. Are you sure you weren't frustrated with the government?
No, we barely knew Napoleon anyways.
My name is Count de Montholon.
It says here that you have ties with some Bourbons who are Napoleon haters. How can you explain this?
We're just friends. Just because my associates hate him, don't mean I hate him.
Let's get to the point. Did you poison Napoleon?
Napoleon? No, I would never poison him. I was one of his most trusted aides. I even prepared his wine. We were that close.
You were the only one with access to his wine.
Though researchers are not positive that Napoleon died from arsenic poisoning, Count de Montholon was a top culprit if the cause of death was actually arsenic. Some people also believe that Napoleon committed suicide, but since the arsenic poisoning was regularly dosed over a period of several years, it is unlikely that Napoleon tried to kill himself through arsenic. Though the most probable cause of death was stomach cancer, there are still suspicions surrounding the famous leader's demise. Napoleon, although small in stature, made an undeniably large impact in the world as we know it. His quick rise to fame was marked with hard-fought battles and sharp, tactical decisions on his part. With a war-savvy and nationalistic mindset, Napoleon was able to change the course of countless wars in France's favor. After gaining control of France, Napoleon revolutionized French economics and law with implementation in the Bank of France and Napoleonic Code. His leadership as an emperor and devotion to his country restored the crumbling post-revolution France to the gleaming, modern, fully functional country seen today.
You're fine.
Hold on to your face.
Bye-bye.
Austria and Russia against France.
My name is Count de Montalot.
It says here that you have ties with Austria.
No!
Excuse me, this is a mockumentary.
Riley.
Do I just get killed?
Army. I don't mean like the people are big. I'm
just saying that
there's more people down in history. That's awesome. So,
wait,
which one do you prefer?
You guys are making the blow of the dog candle! Oh my god!
Daniel.
It's the watermelon!